Welcome and thank you for joining us today. We are very happy to present the Automating Society report to you. And at the Bertelsmann Foundation in the project, The Ethics of Algorithms, we are dealing with the social consequences of ADM, aiming for ensuring that those systems serve society. And in some projects, we are dealing with the potentials of those systems. In other projects, just like as in this one, we are looking more into the areas of control and transparency. So the overall goal for us with the Automating Society report was to provide some more systematic evidence and also to provide some more systematic transparency about the actual status quo of ADM systems and AI-based systems in Europe. And then to use this evidence for raising awareness and also to use it as a concrete basis for recommendations. So this is the second version of the report. It gives a detailed update of the last 2 years. In the first report, the goal was more to raise a general awareness to the topic as such, with ADM systems being the exception rather than the norm. But a lot has changed in the meantime. ADM systems have become much more pervasive and they influence the lives of millions of people in Europe. We've also seen several developments on the policy level and the overall debate on the topic has also developed further, but still more concrete solutions are needed. So with our comprehensive research, we want to form a basis for giving more concrete recommendations. We also need a broad debate on ADM systems and their impact on society. And with this publication, we hope to contribute to this debate. Also, in comparison to the last report, with this one, we have taken a new path with the design of the report, presenting the topic also, for example, in graphic novels. And this is why we want to present the report in two formats, as an interactive website, as well as a PDF version.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Matthias Spielkamp. I'm one of the co-founders and the executive director of AlgorithmWatch. And I guess many in the audience know us already, but for those of you who don't, we are a nonprofit research and advocacy organization based in Berlin. And we set out to commission to watch, unpack, and scrutinize automated decision-making processes and AI-based systems. But we prefer what we call algorithmic or automated decision-making over artificial intelligence because it, in our opinion, better describes the fact that we are not talking about a technology, but about socio-technological systems that are embedded in society and the contexts. So for example, of course, the question whether a machine learning system is accurate, is producing accurate results, is majorly important. But if you, for example, take face recognition, you immediately understand that it's not enough talking about, for example, this accuracy. It needs to be accurate because if it recognizes people, you know, it's clear that it needs to recognize faces of people of color with the same accuracy it recognizes white people, right? But if you go a step further and then see that, for example, a system like that is being used to prevent certain people, let's say people of color, from entering a sports stadium, then you immediately understand what the bigger picture here is and that we are not talking about some accuracy levels of machine learning technologies. So what we need to remember is that this is a discussion about power and justice in society and not about technology. And we think as AlgorithmWatch that the prudent use of such ADM systems can benefit all of us, individuals and societies as a collective. But of course, we need to address the risks with concrete governance mechanisms. And it's high time to establish those mechanisms. And this is exactly what the report shows, as Fabio will explain to you later. But I'd like to also use the opportunity to point out that this is not just a report. This is the result and output of a fantastic network of researchers, of academics, of journalists, and people in 16 countries all over the continent. Actually, there are even more than 16 countries that, where we have, for example, journalistic stories from, but they are not in the report itself because we focus on these 16 countries. And we call this network the Algorithmic Accountability Research and Reporting Network. And now that is a very complicated name for quite a complex issue. But as Sarah said, we need this broad debate about the issues, and this is why we cover not just many countries, but also use these different formats to appeal to different audiences. So the research catalogs is more for academics and maybe policymakers. The journalistic stories are more for a broader audience. And this is why we hope that you will not only find it useful, but hopefully also a little entertaining when you read that. And having said that, I'll just hand over to Fabio Chiusi, who is the editor and also the project manager for this report. And he'll present the core findings and recommendations to you in the next couple of minutes. Fabio, please.
Thank you so much, Matthias. I hope you can hear me. Yeah. And thanks. I would like to start just by thanking everybody that was involved in this project. As Matthias said, it was a really fantastic network of people. And I want to thank both AlgorithmWatch and Bertelsmann, of course, Bertelsmann Stiftung, of course, for providing me the opportunity to work with such a fantastic network of people. I think it did make the difference in the result. And having said that, I would just share my screen. And the presentation is called Life in Automated Society as the introduction of the report, exactly for the reason that Sarah was introducing. The fact that, you know, when we started out a couple of years ago, these systems were the exception rather than the norm. And now the situation is changing so fast that we can basically say that, you know, that even the title of the project may be outdated already, because it probably the automated society, you know, it's already here, possibly. So we probably automated large sectors of society, and we're going to see how. What I wanted to do with this short presentation is basically tackle these three issues, really, which is how we gathered the evidence and what is the report. It's been said already a little bit, but I will expand on that. What kind of evidence did we find? We're an evidence-based organization, so we're not in principle in neither for or against these systems. We just want to understand what they are, how they work, and what kind of opportunities and problems they actually present to those who implement them. So that's the rationale there. And in the last part, we also try to go beyond the description and try to be a little prescriptive and say, how should we regulate or tackle these systems in order for them to be actually beneficial at the maximum level and to be actually consistent with human rights and democracy when they are not, or when they are problematic in this sense. So this is basically the three things I want to present right now. We're still taking stock of ADM in Europe. Taking stock of ADM in Europe was basically part of the title of the first report. And we're still doing that. We found many more examples. So the mapping exercise that we provided, let's say like that, is not over. And it's not over even after this report, I suspect. And we'll see also the reason why pretty soon. But yeah, of course, this is very important to actually understand which systems are being tested, deployed, or contested, or challenged even. Or what results are they producing. And we also try to provide, as I said, some kind of policy recommendations to understand what to do about it. The report, as we said, tackles 16 countries, which is four more than last year. We added four to bring in some more comprehensive analysis to our effort. So we added Greece, Estonia, Switzerland, and Portugal compared to last year. And as we said, it was a team of 40 plus people in the end, you know, even if you think all the people that were involved in both organizations and the hard work they put into, especially over the last weeks. So again, thanks to all of them. We tried to make this study a comprehensive and exhaustive analysis as far as possible, of course, from different perspectives, as Matthias said. And again, what we really take pride in is the looks of the report beyond the content, because I think it's important. It's not just a formality. It's really important for us to understand, for us as practitioners, as people that work inside this space, that we need to broaden our scope and need to reach the most, the broadest possible audience, really, because these systems already influence decisions that matter to all of us. And that is really important for us to understand. That's why we try to have multiple layers to the report. So graphic novel style stories is a big part of it. And I think they really convey the message. They really show how present and current are these systems. We also published a preview report, and I want to remind that if you want to look at it, in August, which is fully dedicated on understanding how this system worked in the and are working really in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. So if you want to have a look at that, we felt it was a really, really important effort and important developments there. So we decided to have actually a whole mini report, let's say like that, dedicated to just that. So we didn't forget about that. It's just in another report, basically, which is part of the same project. and then we can go to the main findings of the report. The first one is the one that we all nodded to, which is from the automated society to the from the automated society, which means basically that automated decision-making system that we call ADM are already part of the everyday life of millions of citizens. And they affect very, very important sectors of their life, their health, their welfare, their job, more broadly, their rights and the distribution of their fundamental services. In many cases, we speak about public services. And so this is really important. And then all the more important, given the fact that these systems are on the rise all over Europe and pretty fast. Let's say that the clearest example of that is face recognition. And face recognition, in the first report, is nearly absent. And you know, when we started working with researchers, we started to brainstorm on the examples, and everybody basically had an example, at least one, concerning face recognition. And that happened over the last year. So this means that the development of these systems in some cases can be really, really fast and possibly too fast. So this is, for example, the case of face recognition in our opinion. Especially given the fact that we have mounting evidence of discriminatory outcomes. And as Matthias said, this is far more far more complex than an accuracy problem. It's like a problem of social justice and inequality, so unfairness. So this is really important. Some of the users, you will find more than 100 examples in the report of actual users of systems that have been either piloted or are in pilot phase or deployed or even challenged and already, you know, scrapped, basically. It can happen. These are all systems that are present in our report. But just to give you a flavor of what we're talking about, these are all actual systems that are operating or have been operational in Europe right now. So we have systems to predict the risk of gender violence, for example, to actually try and understand the risk of committing such crimes, of course, which is very important. And it's not limited to just this Biogen system, which is the oldest one, has been in use for a decade or something. So not all these systems are really new also, but we have also in other countries, we have systems, a lot of them for a kind of all kinds of fraud detections. And so you can have tax fraud detection, you have medical prescription detection. And for example, the medical description fraud system in Portugal is claimed to be working very well, for example. This is something that, you know, it's not, we'll see whether it's the norm or the exception, but some systems are also working pretty well and they're established inside this, the public administration of these countries. We have different countries using this system to best allocate pupils in schools. So to minimize discrimination and segregation, of course. We have systems, for example, one in Italy has been studying for predictive jurisprudence, meaning that, you know, ADM system can assist judges and people in the judiciary to actually understand what's the orientation of the courts on several topics, thus, you know, speeding up the process, We even have smile detection or sound detection systems, which are the more scary to me, like a little dystopian there, but you know, it's just some of the cases, of course. We have other systems, like a very interesting one from Finland, trying to predict life events, which means like, for example, a marriage, changing jobs, you know, things that are tied to your age or to your phase in life, and tries to predict what kind of services you would need correspondingly, so that to maximize efficiency there. And we also have a very important medical applications, for example, for cancer treatments in several hospitals in Switzerland. As you see, we have balloons even in the presentation. And this is one of the most important, I think the most important result, this automated society we're building is opaque, is not transparent as it is right now. And this fundamental lack of transparency is a challenge in itself for us and for everybody who wants to work on this, because it's really tough to get transparency from authorities and from people who deploy such systems. And this needs to change. And we're gonna see right now why. As I said, we're an evidence-based organization again, and this means that, you know, when you lack evidence, it's very difficult for us to provide a judgment and an analysis, an informed analysis of these systems. And of course, this is not acceptable to us, especially given the fact that these systems already affect the lives and rights of many people, of millions of people, actually. Most of the times, this is endemic opacities is usually exactly to prevent scrutiny of the sort that this report tries to convey. And this is, of course, not good. There are a country, even Poland, I think, even mandates opacity around these systems, which is kind of incredible to me personally. But it also means, you know, of course, that when opacity is there and there is no transparency, it means that there is no democratic debate, no proper informed democratic debate around these systems, meaning that we just found them because we look for them very hard. But most of the times we still don't know whether they work, how they work, and what they did exactly with what data, of course. This is another very important finding. And when we try to formulate the judgment on the system, given the knowledge we have, of course, which might be incomplete, is that positive examples and the potential that, of course, the systems have has been realized just in a minority of them. And that is, you know, something that that is just a fact, given the examples that we gather. You know, we don't claim this to be an exhaustive study. We don't claim it to have any kind of statistical significance, you know, but the minority, this is true of the minority of cases that we found. And so the majority of cases instead tend to put people at risk rather than help them. And they are deployed nonetheless, anyway, because of technological solutionism. And I think you might be familiar with that. If you're not, it's the kind of ideological framework according to which most societal problems are actually technological problems in need of technological solutions. And that is, of course, a kind of reductionism that can be very, very problematic when you have social complex problems. I'll try to go a little quicker because I'm a little late to my schedule, but another main finding that is very important, that it has a much more positive connotation to it, is that it is possible to challenge this algorithmic status quo. And part of it has to do with the rules and the norms and the normative framework that the EU has come up with. And that is very important because it empowers the national data protection authorities to intervene. It empowers other subjects to intervene, ombudsperson, for example. But it's also important to remark that, you know, most of these systems, most of the problematic systems have not been deployed when they were deployed have been challenged effectively because there is journalism, because we have academia, because we have civil society caring for that and looking into that and actually taking stances on this, trying to get information, trying to get rights respected. So this is a very important role that we are having, I can say we, in this context, as watchdogs of the automated society, and that should be recognized as such, I think, and we think. Some of the examples in which this challenging exercise of watchdogs and journalism, of civil society, watch dogs, and journalism and academia regard some of the cases that you may have heard about. The Siri case in the Netherlands was a faulty tax fraud detection system and social welfare fraud detection system, was brought to court and halted. We have other issues in which, for example, we have other instances in which, for example, in Sweden, this model for fully automated welfare decisions, you imagine very, very invasive. It was not even, the code was not even public, and the journalist managed to obtain the release of the code, part of it, revealing a privacy violation in the meanwhile. So, you know, it was pretty important. And then also we have face recognition pilot project in train stations in Germany that's been halted after activism intervened. So the real question is to conclude is the policy recommendations that we try to come up with, which are broad, but they're also very concrete and actionable, I think, and should be, I think, adopted. The first thing is to increase the transparency of ADM systems. This is crucial and vital if we want to make the most of these systems, not to deploy them, but actually to better deploy them if we want to. The first thing we need to do is actually to understand them better. So we come up with this idea of mandating at EU level, a law that establishes public registers for ADM systems used within the public sector. And this is also already happening in some cases, even in the absence of such law, like recently it's been, they've been adopted in Helsinki and Amsterdam and other cities around Europe. So this is a start, of course, in the right direction, I think. But it's not enough. Together with that, we need also to be able to access the actual data, the training data that are fed into the algorithms, of course, or the systems. And for that, we need legally binding data access frameworks to support interest, to support research that is in the public interest, as in this case, of course. We need to also create an accountability framework, meaning that somebody must be responsible and accountable for these algorithms, and algorithms should be checked thoroughly. And this means, of course, having auditing processes in place, and having a process to come up with auditing processes in place too, of course. Recognizing civil society organizations as watchdogs of this kind of automated society. And we have a strong one, but I think we're shared with a lot of practitioners and people who actually know these systems. We should be banning face recognition systems, that live users of face recognition systems that might amount to mass surveillance. So this is also something that, of course, is being debated at EU level. We know that, and we think this is the right direction to go. The very last thing I would like to say is that, you know, of course, this is all possible if and only if in a democracy, people are actually empowered to understand what's going on and participate in the discussion and have a kind of algorithmic literacy, as we said. So we should be trying to establish independent centers of expertise that could coordinate such efforts to come up with, you know, enforcement mechanism, oversight mechanism and the like. But we should also promote an inclusive and diverse democratic debate. And inclusiveness and diversity, of course, are a problem in technology. We know that, are a problem in Europe, are a problem worldwide right now. So we need to be taking care of that. I don't want to go too far. So this was my presentation, basically. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Fabio, for this. It's quite a challenge to put the evidence of almost 300 pages report into 15 minutes, but I think you almost succeeded, and for everyone else, you just have to read it. So let's get right into the discussion. We have a fantastic panel here with us today, and we have the European Parliament represented, the European Commission, we have academia, and we have the private sector. So this is a great round of people who to discuss this topic with us. And I'll just give you a quick roundup of who is here, but I'll just introduce everyone briefly, because you can basically look up the achievements on the internet, if you excuse my rudeness here. We have Mia Petra Kumpula Natri, who is the member of the European Parliament for the Progressive Alliance of Socialists and Democrats, and she's a member of the Special Committee on Artificial Intelligence in a Digital Age. She's from Finland, and you can take from this that she's an expert on the issue. Same way that Sergei Lagodinsky is. He is a member of the European Parliament for the Greens, the European Free Alliance, and he's also a member of that special committee on artificial intelligence in a digital age. We have Irina Orsic, who is the team leader for artificial intelligence at the Unit Technologies and Systems for Digitizing Industry at the European Commission's DG Connect. We have Cornelia Kutera, who is the Senior Director for European Government Affairs, Rule of Law, and Responsible Tech at Microsoft. And we have Joanna Bryson, who is a Professor of Ethics and Technology at the Hertie School and a renowned expert on artificial intelligence and automated systems. And before I start with the first question, I would like to tell you that we have an amazing 165 approximately people here joining us today, which is fantastic. And you know, to be honest, this is one of the advantages of this pandemic, because I doubt that we would have assembled 165 people in the European Parliament. We presented the 2019 edition of this last year at the European Parliament, and we were very happy about the turnout, but it was about, if I remember correctly, about 50 to 60 people. So let's also look at the bright side here. It's wonderful that you are all here. At the same time, I of course need to tell you that we will go to questions from the audience soon. Nevertheless, I cannot imagine that we will be able to take all the questions that are coming from the audience to discuss them with our distinguished panel here. So please bear with us if your question does not come up. Hopefully, we will address it somehow else in the rounds that are before us. So the first question I have is a pretty broad one, because I would like to use this to set up the discussion in general. And it's about, of course, the evidence that we collected for the report. Our panelists got a chance to look at it a little earlier than the rest of you, you know, just a couple of days, and it is a long report, but still, my question is whether you think that the governance mechanisms that we have for automated decision-making systems or AI-based systems in the European Union, whether they are appropriate. And if you think they are, then what is the explanation for the fact that there are still so many problematic cases? And if they are not, what needs to be done? Mia Petra, I would like to give this question to you, first of all. What's your take?
Thank you. And it's very challenging week to have a lot of discussions and material. So I will be honest that my assistant went through more, and I have like pinpoints, and then now the presentation here. So I must continue reading. And I also want to be very open that I'm the rapporteur for the data strategy, which tackles so many of these issues in the parliament. So we have still until December, January to add on so and learn more. So that's why I took this invitation to join. But then on your question on the government mechanism in Europe, we do not have many. And that is also what we are now trying to build to the governance for the data spaces. It is actually the tool that European Commission wanted to boost the data flows, that we can have more innovations. But at the same time, it is the proof that we do not have that much data governance in Europe. The GDPR is there, and then it's a very, very good start, but a lot of other issues we do not. And then as coming from Finland, I know that we nationally build up different kind of governance systems for the data. And that is this question now for the Europe. It is the moment to do something together. Then it can be stronger if we are brave enough, because then we can tackle the global ideas and then have the power to say. And then it is the way to avoid a national 27 ways to do the governance for the different data sets. So even though the data governance ideas that the Commission will present maybe in 1 month's time is the idea to boost it, it also is to make it right. And there, I think this is very timely to take your notice on this issue.
Thank you very much. Yes, we of course, we hope to have an influence. But Sergei, the European Parliament has been working on this for quite a long time. So please let us know what your take on this issue is here of governance.
Yeah, I think we should be fair to the Commission and to ourselves. This is, of course, a new issue. And just maybe looking at on the positive side, I think that we had at the beginning, before we started regulating and discussing regulations, we had a conceptual challenge in terms of better understanding what it is. And this has something to do with lack of expertise, maybe also a generational gap in many cases. You know, people who are politicians on the European level and who are members of parliament, they're not an everyday AI business. So it took some time. And I think that the reports that we had and the resolutions that we had in the European Parliament have shown and demonstrated that we have made progress in terms of understanding the challenges and the concepts of what we're talking about. We do have a little bit concern that we still are stuck with terms like artificial intelligence instead of, like in your report, talking about the actual issue, which is the automated decision making. But we are a step forward there. Number two, the second layer is about agreeing on certain guiding principles and positions. And when I look at the reports, and I was the Green Rapporteur, the Shadow Rapporteur on liability report, on ethics report, on some other, especially those in the Jury Committee and Legal Affairs Committee, I think that we do agree on the central principles already. And I know it sounds very basic for someone so advanced like your organization, but it is already a big step forward. It's about human centrism. It's about fundamental principles. It's about anti-bias principles. And also, it is about, important to me, also kind of a green balancing of artificial intelligence as technology, which is part of, for example, a report on ethics and AI. So where we are not there yet is about agreeing and understanding on how to operationalize those principles, especially, for example, using ethics not as I would call a placebo for actual regulation, but as a first step to actual regulation. And also going a step farther, talking about what are the remedies, the legal regulatory remedies that we are ready to agree on. And there are some proposals in the reports, for example, a right to remedy for citizens if they feel that they are treated in an unequal way, right, in cases of bias. But this is not there yet, because there the differences in various political parties' views and perspectives are becoming different. And the fourth point, which I think is important, but where I think we still have a lot of fighting and struggling to do, is how to institutionalize those issues, because we still could not agree, and we saw this in the negotiations. Do we need, for example, a special agency which would deal with various issues in terms of digitalization? How do we involve the experts? How do we involve the stakeholders? These are all issues which are still open for now. Well, we are not the ones who decide on that. We don't have the right of initiative yet. We're waiting for the Commission, and I'm looking at Irina, who I just saw 2 days ago in our session at the Legal Affairs Committee on those issues. What proposals are going to come? And I think that we will get forward on that early next year. But yes, I think there is a gap. There is a gap between regulatory progress and the progress on the ground. I do agree with Mia Petra that the thing we should avoid is a competences competition. We should insist that we need a European and Europe-wide regulation, something that many member states are beginning to challenge now, because if we don't, then we will lose in the global standard setting, and I don't need to provide the arguments for that in this round. So I will stop here, and we can discuss and deepen a little bit later.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sergey, and you couldn't have done a better job as a moderator for setting up this our next speaker, Irina, because you already alluded to the question of, you know, what is going to come from the Commission in this? And yes, we need to be fair. This is a tough job that you have there, Irina. So please fill us in. What are the current ideas? How are you going to address these risks that we are facing?
Yes, thank you very much. So first of all, yes, we do believe that there is not appropriate governance right now. And this is why we published in February this year the white paper on artificial intelligence, putting it really to public discussion. And we had some 1,250 contributions on the online survey, plus we had more than 500 PDF documents. More than half of the contributions came from citizens and from civil society. So one can see that really there is a debate and there is a growing awareness of topics. Now, the points we had put for discussions in February, basically the one or the other way, cover all your recommendations. So what we propose is, okay, it's an approach to artificial intelligence, but this was something we put for discussion, and it might well be that we, after the public consultation, we will be going for a slightly broader approach, because also we want to be future-proof. We are talking about transparency indeed, and that also includes question of a registry, of a public registry, and also the transparency of training data. We want to have a meaningful accountability framework. We want to have liability. We are very much talking about not only facial recognition, but going further, biometric identification, mass surveillance, because we believe that there is now much more in it. There are systems which will recognize you when walking down the street. There are voice recognition systems and others. So on all this, we have launched a debate, and we have launched a specific debate asking for what kind of regulation we would need. There is a second part to this white paper, actually, on an ecosystem of excellence, where we are also talking about literacy and how we can have the necessary skills, not only for the experts to work with the technology, but also in the society to have meaningful discussions. So all this is under discussion, and we will be coming forward with something probably in the beginning of next year, basing us on the white paper, but also as a last word, we already have the Fundamental Rights Charter, we have the Data Protection Acquis, so it is not that we are coming from nothing. And what we want to create is not overlapping frameworks, but we want to create a very, very clear and predictable framework. And indeed, that should apply to all EU member states. And we don't want to have a fragmentation of this, because we believe that there we would have a lot of harm. Very last word, we are also discussing this internationally. Thank you.
Hey, thank you, Irina. I would like to come to you, Cornelia. Representing a global tech leader, Microsoft here, first of all, of course, I want to be fair and ask the same question as to everyone else, whether you think the governance mechanisms are appropriate. But you could also already address what the three other speakers have already said. And for example, what that means for a company like yours. Are you up to these challenges?
Thanks, Matthias. So first of all, let me congratulate the Bertelsmann Stiftung and Algorithm Watch for this wonderful report, which I read with real interest. And some of the evidence I've been aware of, some I haven't. In particular, I was intrigued by the Belgium school system. I went through the same effort on the French-speaking side with my three kids. And I wish the next report will look into the French allocation of schools. I would be intrigued about that. But joke aside, I think Europe has, and Fabio mentioned this in the beginning, has principles and normative principles in place that will be helpful in guiding through the development of trustworthy AI in Europe. What it doesn't have, and this shows, I think, very clearly, the report is governance. I was thinking when reading through some of the examples that had the deployers of those technologies in the specific cases and scenarios had a governance model in place, the outcomes might have been very different. In some cases, maybe the system would have not been rolled out in the first place, or there might have been adaptations and mitigations that would have led to a slightly different application with more benefits for more stakeholders. The point that I'm trying to make here is that, yes, if you operationalize principles that have been developed across the world really on ethical AI, then you have to actually start a much more holistic and with many more stakeholders inclusiveness conversation. What do people need? What are the benefits of this system? How are they distributed across the ecosystem? What are potential harms perceived to which stakeholders, and how could they potentially mitigate it? And this is really what we in Microsoft have been doing over the last 2 years. And in fact, we're at this stage at the release of our second version of the internal standard in operationalizing ethical AI, the principles that we have been publishing 3 years ago. And this requires really, as Fabio also mentioned, this socio-technical perspective in approaching fairness and other important aspects. I forgot, Matthias, what the second question was, but yes, I assume we get to the recommendations in more details later. So I stop there then.
Okay, thank you very much, Cornelia. Well, I wanted to know how Microsoft is going to deal with that challenge of more regulation, more governance coming up. But yes, we can address that in the next round. And one word of housekeeping to all the people in the audience. Please address your questions when you write them in the chat to the panelists and the attendees both at the same time. You have that option to do so. So it makes it a lot easier for us to moderate this and to pick the questions that we would like to hand also to the panel participants. Okay, Joanna. Joanna Bryson, in your title at Hertie School, it already says governance. You are a professor for AI governance, and that, of course, makes this very intriguing to have you here on this panel. Now, was that addressed appropriately by the other panel members already?
The 2 minutes, I don't know where to start. I think I'll go back to what I was going to say instead of answering the question you just asked, which is going back to your first question. I think that one thing people don't realize in terms of governance, I'm going to give two different answers for two different sides. One is there enough sort of regulatory structure in place? And I think people don't recognize the extent to which we do have adequate regulatory structure in place, because we don't see how artificial intelligence is a manufactured product. We think it's some new magic thing. And so then the sector has been underregulated as a consequence of people feeling that they don't have obligations to be able to prove due diligence, to be able to keep track of what was the testing procedures, what were the outcomes, to have, you know, what were the desiderata, what was intended by the system, how did we know it was safe for release? All of these things that we would ordinarily do for any manufactured product, we can do with AI. In fact, with digital technology, it's easier to keep these kinds of records. And yet people don't choose to do it. They aren't even doing the level of, it's called development and operations, DevOps. They're not even doing the level that ordinary software developers are doing now. There's something about AI, you know, the mysticism, maybe you're right, the name, that is allowing people to get away with behaving badly. So I think that we do have if we think about, with respect to liability, you know, we think, oh, it's not a product, it's a service. No, it's a product that performs a service, but that product that performs the service is still a product. And so people still have obligations, both as developers of that product, manufacturers of that product, and also as owners and operators of that product. So there's been a lot of wiggling around the law in ways that I hope we can fix. And this comes to where we do have a shortfall, is that expertise. And I have been meeting more and more people who do get it. We have been working really hard on this in Europe, and I think we are increasing in our competence. Apparently, we produce more PhDs in AI here than in any other global region. We have more developers. And so just bringing this into government and making sure the right people are at the right place. And I know this is a long 2 minutes, but quickly, don't let the technologists make it hard. Their obligation, if the developers are the ones who are obliged to make their systems transparent to you, the governors. So you don't have to hire all PhDs from MIT to be able to go through and surveil these, you know, to check whether due diligence was followed. It is the obligations of the companies, and I think it should be proportionate to that. We should allow the companies to decide what is our liability, and then to produce adequate transparency proportionate to their liability risk. But in order to motivate them to do that, we have to be imposing better than we have done so far. For example, on Facebook, we have to impose liability on these failures.
So there you have it. Thank you very much, Joanna. The systems are products, and the products can be tested and they can be audited. Now I hand this back to Irina and Mia Petra and Sergei, because you are the triad here of people who are making the rules. Please, Irina, how are you going to address this?
That's the $100 million question, which is right now under discussion. So what we are planning is to come indeed forward with several aspects of frameworks on safety and liability. And as Jana just said, there are already a number of frameworks in place on product safety, on liability. So to look into them and to see where new technologies require also new legal rules. And then the other thing is a horizontal framework, which indeed should cover only high-risk applications and not all the applications. And there, for these high-risk applications, we would be planning to have certain requirements, certain criteria, and that would be subject to an ex-ante conformity assessment.
Mia Petra. Is this sufficient?
All what Irina said, as they have the right of initiative from the Commission side, is sufficient a lot. My worry is that there is so much that we talk about an elephant, and eating an elephant at the time is quite impossible. And the risk is that we end up talking and preparing and monitoring and analyzing, and then seeing that world went so fast. It is not the first time that technology goes faster than the politics could. And that's why I very much hope that the Commission would give some very concrete ones. For example, when we want to increase the transparency, the saying that when we at the same time ask the public sector to open the data to have more possibilities for innovations and better online, better real-time services, for example, we could say that it's a must that you have to avoid black boxes, that you have to have open algorithms so that it can be evaluated. We do have fundamental rights and very good principles in many legislation. But then what is lacking, then we should fill that gap and take them to parliament and make it rule before we ask eagerly the public sector to open its data. And I must comment here that I very much emphasize that also the idea of being a watchdogs, it is the very same thing, that the society has to be open for the journalists to be freely watchdogs over the politics working. And what I appreciate here that you do have, for example, the examples that where the facial recognition is already looked at. If you follow the public hearing of the AIDA committee, it was also the Vestager who said that the public places, there are very much rules. And then again, what is the public place? Is it the public place when you enter the train or is it not? So all these, I just wish that Irina and your team, you will come soon with a lot of concrete legislative proposals, like the public said, algorithms must not be hidden in the black box to be able to serve the public decision making. That could be one, and not to wait for one pillar of the AI to handle all of these issues.
Okay, thank you very much, Mia Petra. Joanna, I saw that you raised your hand, but still I would like to ask Sergei just briefly to comment on this question of liability, because you addressed it in the first round, because that seems to be one of the major issues here, where we can hold the makers of these systems accountable, but at the same time presents one of the greatest challenges.
Yes, well, generally, it's one of the points that is important, and this is speaking of the mysticism of the artificial intelligence, as Joanna called it. We have to destroy this narrative, the narrative that it's some other personality making decisions. People make decisions, and they should be accountable. What we were doing in our report in the Legal Affairs Committee, it was about civil liability of operators mostly. It was less about developers because we didn't want to infringe on the product liability issues that would be regulated by another committee. But generally, it is important in that respect to establish the human agency and human liability and accountability on all levels. It is about data sets, and we're looking forward to the data proposals by the Commission. And it is also about depository of technology and of data, and also of technological manuals. And there the question is institutional. How do we design the institution and the governance so that we don't get into a situation where there is a damage, but we cannot, we just lack any information about how to trace it back to the human agent who is responsible for the decisions that were made while the manufacturing, during the manufacturing phase. And there we are with the institutional challenge. And frankly, I don't know how my colleagues from more conservative or market-oriented groups, from the Liberals and from the Conservative Party, I know that Social Democrats are more open towards that, are going to deal with the issue of an agency, because they reject it. They reject any new institution that would be able to make these decisions, to keep this depository, et cetera, et cetera. This is something that we will have to discuss. I think we need to designate either existing or a new agency or an independent body which would do these things, because only if we have transparency and explainability, yes, this was mentioned as well, transparency for the liability cases, but also explainability for the public and for the rulemakers who have no idea what they're talking about, only then we will be able to trace back also the liability and the accountability issues.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much. And just because you mentioned it, we did send out invitations to members of parliament from the Liberals and the Conservatives. And unfortunately, no one was able to be here with us today. I do not think it was for substantial reasons. It's just a matter of timing. You know, there's so many things going on in Brussels at the same time. But of course, it would have been interesting to discuss it with representatives of the Liberals and the Conservatives. So Joanna, please.
Yeah, I actually am a Liberal Democrat in the UK, but anyway, let's get to the point here. I really wanted to come in on this black box point to clarify a little bit of that. because that was one thing I thought was problematic with the report, the white paper. There's at least three kinds of transparency that we can be talking about here. One is software that is, you know, all written in human readable formats, often called symbolic AI. And there are definitely people pushing for that, especially specialists in symbolic AI. And it can have some really important and useful roles. But I don't think we should exclude the other types. That was why I mentioned before this DevOps idea. There's a form of transparency, which is we know the system works this way because it was intended to, right? Or we can go back and see, or because people didn't test it carefully enough, right? So we can go back and see, were the proper processes followed? And then there's a third kind of transparency, which is called digital forensics. So you even if you can't understand anything about a system, you can still see, would you get a different answer if you ran it with slightly different parameters? And again, with digital technology, it's relatively quick to do that. And so we can go and find out, was there something either by negligence or intent, or just, you know, we hadn't thought hard enough about it before. Why was it that there was a border that turned out to be a protected characteristic or something like that? Or was it a legitimate, like, oh yeah, you know, that is actually an important idea. Those people are better at doing that job. Good discovery AI, right? So digital forensics is another point to put up there. And then finally, about this open data and trade secrets, I really want to commend Microsoft. This is one thing, I'm not a huge fan of Microsoft software, but their ethics has been great. They've been showing real leadership in these areas. And one of the things they have is something they call a transparency, something about transparency, I forgot what it's called. Transparency
Centers.
Yeah, so they don't allow academics like me there, but at least they say, look, we know that there's some things governments are good for. And I think it's probably mostly cybersecurity, and they should open up maybe a little more kinds of transparency centers too. But you know, pharmaceuticals have 10 times more IP than tech, and yet they are well regulated. The idea that openness means that there's no trade secrets is just false. What you have to do is to be able to trust that you could build up a decent enough governance structures that there are people that can come in and help you demonstrate that you've done the right thing. And I think we can do that. And I think Microsoft is showing leadership in that area.
Yeah, now you stole my question, Joanna, but I'm really grateful for it because gives the opportunity for Cornelia to answer to this. But I would like to try to tie it to a question that already came from the audience, because we need to go to the audience questions now. It's already 2:15. So it's my duty here, and it's really difficult to combine a couple of questions that I saw in the chat. So Cornelia, we were already talking about the transparency centers. Could they be a model for providing more transparency and auditability of these systems that we are talking about? And do you see a problem there with trade secrets, or is that something that we can overcome by, for example, using such structures, which would also address the points that were made by Irina, Sergei, and Mia Petra?
Okay, difficult question. So let me start with saying I'm really appreciative if Shona says something nice about Microsoft, because I know she can be, and rightly so, be a scrutinizing company. So nevertheless, appreciate it. The way we are currently implementing, and I think you will hear over time more about this publicly as well, our ethical principles is through a governance model, through tools, we call that tools, but largely what it is like our researchers like Hannah Wallach, Kate Crawford, Eric Horitz, that try in context with many more researchers to come up with solutions to make these principles a reality. So how do you create accountability? How do you create transparency in these systems? So there's tools that have been developed that we are deploying in our standards ourselves across the engineering groups, such as data sheets for data sets, data documentation, or for our customers when they use technologies, notes, we call them notes, for example, face API note, transparency note, which gives a real indication how the technology should be used, what needs to be considered, et cetera, et cetera. And then of course, we also develop tools that are now built in the machine learning platform, our Azure machine learning platform, for our customers to enable them to be more transparent and them to be more accountable. So what we basically have been trying to implement over the last 2 years internally, and it's a huge effort. And frankly speaking, it goes as far as each Microsoft employee has an obligation to go through a responsible AI training at all, not only those who are actually working on it, but everybody. But it's just one step. There's much more to that. So it's a governance model with leadership responsible for the implementation across all engineering groups and the sales organizations. And we do have an escalation process when there are conversations with customers where people feel there are sensitive uses. And I wanna say two sentences on this, that they can be reviewed by a committee in order to establish whether these potential issues can be mitigated or whether, for example, we cannot do these contractual arrangements with the customer. The way we have departmentalized this is through denying consequential services, risk of harm, it's more safety issues, and then infringement of human rights. In your report, you have pulled together the human rights infringements with the what we call denial of consequential services. And I think there should be some distinctions to this, but I would say that we are in strong alignment that the public sector has a very high responsibility in making right that there's many of the examples that you have in your report really relate to government public services that can lead to denial of consequential services, and a public register and transparency in the spaces is necessary. But it's just one, transparency helps, but governance is really important as well in order to make those who deploy the technologies really think through the intent, document the intent, and then build the mechanisms to review this. And I'm afraid that this type of thinking is currently not thought through in how you can actually legislate around this. But I think that's what's currently missing.
Okay, thank you very much. I mean, it is a complex topic that we're discussing here. And we can now see from your answer that even when it comes to the definition of governance, there may be some different opinions, because from what we say is that transparency obligations are a core part of the governance structure that would have to be established. Sergey and Irina, there was a question in the chat, and I think it's really important, about how to get the public sort of in the loop. You know, I would first go to you, Sergey, because you're a member of the parliament. The parliament is representing the citizens of Europe. But still, there's a lot of debate of how to get citizens more involved in the decisions that we are talking about here, whether to deploy, develop and deploy automated decision-making systems, and if they are deployed, how to deal with them. Now, is that something that you are looking at, finding ways to get more people involved, or do you say that this even increases the complexity of coming up with some clear guidance on how to build governance of these systems?
Well, I think maybe on two points which were already mentioned, but maybe just to emphasize them, I think involving the public in a broader sense should be done in three ways. First of all, by setting standards for what we mentioned, for explainability of those technologies. This is something, and I see that as Microsoft in this case takes their responsibility seriously, I think this is an expectation that we have from both public and private actors if they're large enough. We don't want to overburden smaller actors, of course. Number two, I think it is important also to keep the doors open and the gates open for broader public. And there, I'm not sure, maybe Microsoft will not be happy and Cornelia will correct me, but I think that this is also a matter of anti-monopoly legislation. And we had this discussion yesterday in our subcommittee with Vestager, and where I asked, how will, for example, the data strategy make sure that we will not narrow the opportunity to participate in the data and to profit from the data only to the big companies. Number three is involving and engaging both experts, because experts are also part of the public, and experts can sometimes contribute to the explainability of what is actually going on. And by the way, your report is wonderful on that point, with the graphics, and this is terrific. Even I understood many things that I didn't understand before, and that's already an accomplishment. Also part of this number three, experts, but also of course stakeholders, and this is where, you know, in the liability report we were discussing of how to designate what kind of technologies should be designated as high risk, because on that the liability is intended to be a no fault liability, automatic liability, for example, higher standards for liability. And on that, we should not leave it up to, I'm sorry, the commission, sorry, Irina, and we should not leave it up to experts proper, but we also should involve stakeholders like Algorithm Watches and other, who of course look at this from their perspective and represent the interests of the public and of citizens. So these are kind of the three levels we can start playing, and that's when we will get to this trust ecosystem, as the commission likes to call it, where we would actually have the public not just being objects of this wave going over them, right? That's like your report, but they are subjects, they are actors, and they can actually be part of this process.
Irina, I basically don't even have to ask a question, but you can react to this directly.
No, I take it from Sergei's last point, the role of the commission. I agree, and I believe we need a societal dialogue, and we need a dialogue really on the big questions, like where do we want to be? What is the world we want to live in? Now, this is obviously not DG Connect to run at all, but I think it's really for each of us in private life and professional life, just to have these discussions, to encourage these discussions, and indeed it is for politicians as well. But I believe this is a crucial midterm, long-term question. Now, since I already said this is not my business, what we are doing is, so we had the public consultation, which was open to everybody. And not only that it was like hidden open, but we were talking to everybody, and we were really trying also to have some publicity for it, that we really want to talk to everybody. And we did not only consult in written, but we were talking to plenty of people, and we were talking to plenty of NGOs and civil society organizations. And whoever feels talking to us, you're welcome. We have an open ear, and there is still also a bit of time to contribute with your thinking to what we are doing. And then it goes to the parliament. So from a certain moment, you will call the members of the parliament, like Sergei and Mia Petra, to tell them what you're thinking. But I think everybody here is open and everybody is curious, because it is such a cross-cutting subject. So we had plenty of stakeholders. We also had, as an annual event now for the second time, the AI Alliance Assembly, which started last year for the first time, and which I found striking, because this is unlike other events where you have normally like the organized the organized audience. It was open to everybody. It was also broadly publicized, really, with citizens. And it's a mixture of everybody interested in artificial intelligence coming together to discuss. And you sometimes have very surprising discussions because you have people you didn't listen to before, also perhaps because they're not organized. And this is also a forum for us to get input. And this is also very, very important. And I would just hope to be to witness many of these discussions all around. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And I already also have to have an eye on the clock. And Mia Petra has already left, so just you know what happened, because she needs to answer to the Committee on Artificial Intelligence. This is why she's not here with us anymore. But Joanna, it's already the last round, unfortunately. I mean, we could go on with this for a long time, as usual. But there was one question that I think fits quite well here, and that is that civil society is apparently, I mean, that is the contention here, mostly non-technical and even skeptical when it comes to science. And is there any idea how to establish a meaningful dialogue? Of course, I would not accept that myself, but I'm the moderator here and not a panelist. So please, you are, as an academic and as a scientist, what is your answer to this?
Wow, that is such a huge question. People used to say if we were on Twitter, people would trust us more. And some of us are on Twitter. You know, that if we make our give away our papers, we do give away our papers. Sometimes people get mad if they hit a paywall. But if you just search for the title of the paper, you'll find a free version. It's actually the law in the UK, I think, and it's the norm. It's been the norm for decades. But I think part of the polarization that we see and this distrust of expertise, I mean, sometimes it's grounded. There are some bad things and we do have to hold people to good standards. But part of it is about identity, and a lot of the identity politics are worse in periods of high inequality. So I think this is, again, a larger social problem. It gets blamed on technology, it gets blamed on social media. We can try to communicate by methods like this, and I think you've done a really good, you've provided a very good public good in these kinds of, you know, not only your report, which is fantastic, but even having these kinds of events. But I do think we have to fundamentally address the things that people feel that they're under assault, because they are under assault. And we have to acknowledge that the places that vote for populists, if you look by county, it's the people who have been most economically, not just disadvantaged, the rich and the poor, when inequality gets too gross, have fear. And then with fear, you get identity politics. So this isn't only about technology, it is, going back to Microsoft, when you have these big companies with large amounts of market capitalization, just enormous quantities of money that they can't even legally spend, you have to say this is underregulated and we need to think about how to raise revenue appropriately and distribute it across society appropriately. And maybe I don't sound like a liberal right now, maybe I do sound like a socialist, but anyone who reads history should know that we're in a situation like led to the World War, the First World War, which led to the Second World War. So I think we need to get back onto redistribution and building infrastructure and making sure all of society is included and has social mobility so that they know someone. Everyone should know someone who knows someone who is a technologist, that they should have someone they can phone up and ask these questions that they can trust. And they should know that how much more education they would need to go and become a programmer themselves. If they saw that there wasn't that division in society, then I think they would have more faith. And I think we've allowed society to get too many divisions.
Okay, so let's try to build that faith again. We hope we could contribute a little, not just by the report, but by the discussion that we just had. And I'm really respectful of people's schedules, so I don't want to go over time, and it is 2:30. So unfortunately, you know, some things were not addressed. All things are never addressed in panels like these. That's how life is. Thank you so much for everyone for taking the time and discussing with us, and also at least having a glimpse of the report. We will try to answer more questions when they are posed to us directly as an organization via our channels, via Twitter or Facebook or email. I can only say for today, Thank you very much to all. Please have a look at our website, automatingsociety.algorithmwatch.org. There you'll find the report as a PDF with all the great comics, but also as an interactive website. And we'll continue this discussion for the years to come. So have a good one, everyone. Stay safe.